Welcome to your daily dose of Star Trek, a joint production between Married with Comics and Batman Books, The Dark Knight in Prose, where Layne and Maggie and I read, chapter by chapter, Diane Duane's The Wounded Sky, published by Pocket Books from 1983. Chapter 3. The actual attendance was closer to 300. Many people on shift managed to get dispensations to come down and see the Homalki, who would be assisting with their presentation. Even with the extra personnel, however, the briefing started on time. The audience was seated or standing or squatting or sprawling or hung up 5 minutes before the time appointed. Lieutenant Tanzer had dug up a pedestal for Kittelik to perch on and had set it up just to one side of the huge main screen. In the subdued light of the room, she glimmered like cut crystal in the spot trained on her, and every time she gestured, which was often, dazzle flickered around. "The heart of the problem, of course," she said by way of introduction, "has been the humanities have been confined to our own galaxy since all our species' births. Even the invention of the warp drive wasn't enough to liberate us." "The warp drive, which is fine for transiting intragalactic distances, a few thousand light years at a time, say, on the longest hauls, is completely unequal to the distances involved in intergalactic travel. No modification of the warp drive has enabled it to sustain high enough warp factors for a long enough period to cover those immense distances in anything like a realistic fashion. Even at the lower speeds, with such extended use, you start running into problems like dilithium crystal embrittlement, plasma bottle deterioration, and that kind of thing. There was also the problem of the so-called energy barrier around the galaxy." Kittelik gestured a couple of blown glass legs at the screen, which lit with a schematic of that spiral arm of the galaxy where the previous Enterprise had attempted to leave the Milky Way with such disastrous results. "Now the astronomers and astrophysicists just about went crazy when that barrier was found, since there was no reason for such a thing to exist, any more than there was an actual edge to the galaxy. What we've found since the last attempted penetration, much to everyone's relief, is that there is no energy barrier. What the Enterprise experienced the last time was a transient effect, an encounter with the leading wave front of a megabubble." To the image on the screen was added a huge curved line that cut a little way into the spiral arm. "The wavefront carried with it a sleet of hard radiation, gamma and delta tachyons and baryons, and other such exotic particles, blasted out of the core of a metastar exploding in the heart of one of our galaxy's satellite globular clusters." The cluster in question pulsed slowly on the screen. "That wavefront is still expanding. But we won't have to worry about its impact on the inhabited worlds for some 9,000 years yet. More important is what we know now, that we can get out of the galaxy without the crew going insane. Once that word got out, people all over the Federation started looking for ways to manage it." Kittelik waved several of her back legs at the screen again. It changed view to show a 2D representation of a 3D diagram, a flat gridded surface which seemed to have odd diamond-shaped structures budding out of it in several places. "The avenue of research that my team and I pursued with Tepask and Civic at the Vulcan Science Academy," Kittelik said, "was an investigation into a means of access to a particular alternate universe. It is called De Sitter space, after the Terran mathematician who first postulated its existence some centuries ago. Calling it a universe is a misnomer, really, for it is larger than universes. It is a space. Infinite, in a sense mathematically transcending the Euclidean flat infinity, in that it is multidimensional. How many other dimensions are involved, we're not sure. But we know of at least 8, having worked with them. Within this space, universes can be generated, like multidimensional bubbles. Are generated, in fact. And the evidence seems to indicate that our own universe was produced this way." The screen changed, showing a close-up of one of the bud universes and adding a data table on the space that surrounded it. "The generation itself didn't interest us as much as the space in which it occurs," Kittelik said. "De Sitter space is infinitely hot and infinitely massful. It possesses infinite vector and acceleration qualities, stored holographically in every part of it. The overall effect of disinter space is as if you had a whole universe crammed full of black holes, compressing themselves to the ultimate limits of compression and beyond. However dense and hot you're imagining it, a million times hotter and denser than that, and on in the same way. Infinite mass. Kittelik paused to let the concept sink in, and there was a fascinated, uneasy rustling in the room as crew people got the idea and turned to trade glances. Nothing can exist under such conditions. No particle, however elementary. Even super-compressed matter like a neutron fluid would, in de Sitter space, be crushed out of existence in the instant of its appearance there. In this completely occupied space, nothing in fact exists. Nothing can. It is a whole infinite space that is one limitless naked singularity. The laws of space and time and the other dimensions are meaningless there. They cannot exist there either. The room got quiet as Kittelik looked up at the screen, which changed to reveal a barren, stony planet circling a weary-looking red sun. "This is the site of our first test with infinite mass," Kittelik said with some relish. "Based on equations that we developed jointly with the Vulcans, and with some use of selective ordinance, a homunky mathematical-philosophical technique that some people have been calling creative physics, we built an apparatus that would tap into de Sitter space for an extremely tiny fragment of time and materialize a very small speck of it in our universe. This was the result." The second counter on the screen sprang to life, digits racing backward toward zero. Zero came, and something happened. Just what was impossible to say, since it took no time. But at the non-sight of it, many crew people shuddered. One of those tremors that comes out of nowhere, and then many exclaimed softly, for where the planet had been, there was nothing. Nothing, not a speck of debris. Only that tired red star, bereft of company now. "What you saw just then was a hypercompression," Kittelik said. "The apparatus that produced it and the planet on which it was built were both hypercompressed into the pinpoint of de Sitter space in zero time, and completely out of physical existence." The rustling in the room this time had an involuntary sound to it, as if people were having second thoughts about being in the same ship with such an apparatus. "The device we're installing in Enterprise," said Kittelik, "works on exactly the same principle. Oh, slightly different, in that the apparatus will be inside the ship, rather than on the surface of a planet, but the result is the same once it's achieved. Any object containing a speck of infinite mass is going to be instantly crushed against the infinitely massive object's surface, and faster than instantly, in zero time. For where infinite mass exists, by definition the laws of space-time are briefly abolished. In zero time, the infinite mass to be generated inside Enterprise will pull the entire starship literally inside out, collapsing it into negative curvature. Some of you may have trouble with that image. The closest I can come to explaining it is to suggest that you imagine blowing up a bubble, and then deflating it, sucking the air out of it until it vanishes, and begins inflating again, somewhere else, backwards." Kittelik made an abrupt, disorganized chime rattle that sounded like an embarrassed cough. "My apologies, everybody, if the simile is poor, but the mathematics which is more precise takes a long time to master. At any rate, at another part of zero time, set during the generation of the point of infinite mass, the negative curvature and the ship expressed by it run all the way down to the bottom of the negative curvature spectrum and out the other side, back into positive curvature, at which time the infinite mass expires and the starship which has been containing it pops out elsewhere in the originating spacetime, as far elsewhere as you desire, and in whatever direction, since an infinite number of vectors and accelerations are implicit in de Sitter space. You can go a light year, or 50, or 50,000, and out of the galaxy at last, clear to the next one, or, if you like, beyond." All around the room, people were quietly invoking their deities or support systems. Many trembled, and the eyes of many shone, those of them who had eyes anyway, And, over the ship-wide circuit, left open for questions from the on-shift crew, came a drawly voice that said very definitively, "I don't like it." Spock, who was standing off to one side of the podium and waiting for his part of the presentation to begin, looked wearily off to one side and said nothing. Kittalik laughed, a delicate chiming, and preened herself with her forelegs for a moment. "That would be Dr. McCulpy," she said, "who doesn't care for having his atoms scrambled about by the transporter." "There's something indecent about this whole thing," McCoy's voice said from sickbay, "and I'm seriously thinking of getting a transfer to a safer ship, one working the Romulan neutral zone, say, or close approach Nova Patrol."
"Indecent is an excellent word for it, Doctor," Kadilic said merrily. "So is illegal. The equations from which the access to Desiter space is derived break many known laws of physics, and a few we didn't suspect existed until we broke them. We are, in fact, dealing with an area beyond natural law, one in which it's possible to hypercompress you into a state so small and compact to be detected, even with a tachyon microscope, and, in zero time, restore you to your marvelously testy self, with the testiness not a shade the worse for it afterwards. There's no time for damage to be done to your cells, or for anything else to happen. There's no time."
"That's as may be," McCoy said, a touch subdued by the whispery laughter that went through the rec deck. "But Adam scrambling aside, there's something that bothers me more. In the transporter, there's a brief but measurable period during which I don't exist."
"You will not exist for zero time during this process as well," Kittalik said. "However, the Enterprise will also be in non-existence at the time, and from your point, so will the rest of the universe. You'll have nothing to compare your non-existence against. The philosophical and ethical questions are pretty ones. I'd love to discuss them with you at length later, if you have time. For the moment, though, what I can tell you for certain is that I've been through inversion some 50 times now during prototype testing, and I missed it every time." She trailed off, sounding wistful. McCoy grumbled something inaudible and said nothing further. "By the way," Kittalik said then, "for those of you of Terran ancestry, the use of this drive will entitle you to a share of the prize anciently ordained by someone called Lloyd of London, a prize to be awarded to the first person or persons to take a ship through a black hole or other singularity and return to report the results. I understand the authorities have ruled that Desiter space qualifies as a singularity, so you're all eligible for a share in the award. They say the money has piled up quite a bit over the centuries, what with compound interest and multiple reevaluation of currencies. If I understand the present state of the purse account, I think you people might be able to buy Starfleet if you pooled your resources."
There was laughter in the audience, some grim, some amused. A young Earth human woman with long dark curly hair wearing Defense Department gold raised her hand and stood when Kittalik called on her.
"Please correct me if I'm wrong, madam," she said in a sweet voice with a pronounced Oxonian accent, "but it sounds as if this apparatus has definite possibilities as a weapon."
"Oh, yes," Kittalik said dryly. "Hold a speck of infinite mass in one place for more than a tiny bit of time, and it starts pulling all the matter in the universe toward it at a shocking rate. That's even if it's out in the middle of nowhere. You can imagine the results of dropping a running apparatus into, say, the hyperstar field at the galactic core, where things are strange enough already. Better not imagine it. We have some investment in keeping this apparatus away from the Klingons and Romulans for the time being. Captain Gurr, we'll speak about that later."
The room buzzed. A tall, lean Altassa unfolded herself out of her crotch and triple-voiced her question in Basso Alton Ululation.
"Description, paradox, contradiction, and, as stated, possibility, time travel."
"There are a lot of paradoxes in the equations, yes," Kittalik said, sounding cheerful and unconcerned. "I wrote most of the principal equations myself, and tested all of them, yet I'm still unsure how the results proceed from those equations, and the Vulcans who worked with me seem to think we may never know. All I can tell you for certain is that they work. So at this point, figuring everything out can wait. Seeing that the equations do produce a result we can turn to advantage. And yes, there is a possibility that the apparatus could be used for time travel, or travel along any number of time-like and space-like axes, continua you might call them, which are implicit in Desiter space.
but I think we'd best get regular space travel worked out before we start mudding about with the temporal coordinates.
Marking, Spock said, sotto voice from one side.
Thank you, yes. Is that all for the moment? Then Mr. Spock can go on with his part.
Kittelik flattened herself on her pedestal and stilled her chiming as Spock stepped up beside the screen.
Seeing that we are now free of the galaxy, he began, standing straight and still, Starfleet's mission for us involves a brief journey out of it, as far as one of our closer galactic neighbors, the Lesser Meganellic Cloud. The view on the screen changed to show a schematic of the local group, the association of 20 galaxies, of which the Milky Way and the Andromeda Galaxy were the two largest. Closer to the Milky Way's huge spiral, the Lesser Meganellic was circled and data-tagged by the computer. It was much smaller than the two great spirals, just a bright, elongated spatter of stars, slightly thicker at one end than at the other. The object is not properly a cloud, of course, but a type IO irregular galaxy, and along with its companion, the Greater Meganellic Cloud, a satellite of our own galaxy. The Greater Cloud is in fact slightly closer, 190,000 light-years away, as opposed to the Lesser Cloud's 200,000. But the Small Cloud has been more extensively studied for some years, particularly at Cepheid variable stars. On the screen, the spatter of light became a time-compressed close-up, in which many bright stars slowly pulsed brighter and fainter in a myriad of cycles. These stars have been used for centuries to determine galactic distances. Now, however, we will be using them as navigational beacons. This one in particular, and the screen tightened, to one blue-white star that burned high, sank low, burned bright again. DG Magellanus Minoris in the cloud cluster NGC 121. Its cycle of 89.39 hours is one of the shortest of any Cepheid and easily identifiable. Locked on this star, we will transit using the inversion apparatus so as to emerge about 1,000 light-years from the fringes of the smaller cloud, making in zero time a change in position that would take us some 283 years at warp 9. He let the wondering murmur in the room die down before continuing. We are then instructed to make 10 more short transits in the smaller cloud, using long-range sensors to begin preliminary mapping of the stars and planetary systems affiliated with varied Cepheids. Once survey is completed, we are to transit back outside the smaller cloud once more and begin making our way back to our home galaxy by a series of 36 transits, during which we will be sowing an equivalent number of long-range navigational buoys in a cubic array to serve as reference points in extragalactic space for future missions. Spock turned to one side, stepping away from the screen. Captain? Captain Kirk stepped up in front of the mass of crew people and surveyed them for a moment. Starfleet has given us no other orders, he said, except that we take due precautions before investigating anything we feel needs investigating. However, you should know that the Klingons have been fainting in this area of late. They know we've been testing a drive that doesn't depend on the warp principle. It's a fair bet they'll come after us as soon as we're out of Federation space and try to take it from us. If they start trouble, we'll do what's necessary to handle it. But I have an obligation not to allow the inversion apparatus to fall into their hands on any account. Starfleet was very definite on that matter. He paused to let them understand what he meant by that. The stillness in the room said that they understood very well. Anyone wanting to decline this mission may do so without prejudice to their record. So, comment. The room rustled, and one voice spoke, probably one of the Mizarthu crew people to judge by the holophasic speech and the growly voice.
Respect you, sir. We stopping. Talking. Hurry up. Go!
The place erupted in cheering and howling, screeches and hoots and noisy applause. Kirk got down off the platform and headed for his quarters, and the card game, waiting only till the lift doors shut on him, to let out the grin.
Trekker Talk.
A fan podcast devoted to the adventures of 23rd century bounty hunter Mercy St. Clair from the pages of Trekker Comics by writer and artist Ron Randall.
I'm Darren.
And I'm Ruth.
Please join us as we discuss the stories, characters, and art in this excellent retro sci-fi adventure series.
Special episodes feature interviews with Ron Randall himself discussing Trekker and his other comics.
We hope you'll join us as we travel from the dangerous backstreets of New Gallif to the depths of outer space and everywhere in between.
Listen at Podbean, iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and YouTube.
Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, or visit TrekkerTalk.com.
Trekker Talk is part of the Rad Adventures Network at RadAdventuresNetwork.com.
One sign of Diane Duane's skill as a writer is that she can make a briefing room scene interesting. This one's kind of fun because she's talking about actual physics, or at least the theoretical kind. Things like desitter space. It's D-E-S-I-T-T-E-R. It's space. I've heard a little bit about it in a couple of science classes I have. It is way beyond anything I understand, but it is a real concept. So it is really neat that she's using actual things in order to make this a sort of reality, as it were. Other than that, that's all I really have for this comment-wise. We will be back with Chapter 4 very soon. So to all of you, stay safe, live long, and prosper.